Hi, Dave. How you doing?
Hey, I'm good, Mark. How are you, man?
Good, mate. Thanks for taking the time out from your rehearsals to talk to me. Now, you're currently in LA gearing up for a North American tour. Is it a whole new ball game going on tour with yourself, wholly the writer and performer, as opposed to the lead singer of Depeche?
Yeah, I mean, it's I'm having a blast right now. It's like I my band are rocking. Knox Chandler's playing guitar, so I wrote the songs with. I got Martin Lenoble on bass, Victor Andrizzo on drums, and Vince Jones on keyboards. And we're just having a blast. It's great. We're performing pretty much all Paper Monsters, and we've been rehearsing like 5 or 6 Depeche songs too, and they sound great.
What's your motivation for recording the solo album after such a long period being part of a collaborative?
Yeah, well, I just, you know what, it was just like an overwhelming feeling that it was just time. And these songs had been, kind of been like writing and working on, over the course of the last 3 years or something. So it was kind of like we had like, I had a lot of songs in the can that were demoed. And once really I got the chance, and after the last Depeche tour, the Exciter tour, which ended at the end of 2002, I had no doubt in my mind that I just couldn't wait to get in the studio, basically. We finished that tour, and I was in the studio by sort of, end of January the following year. I was lucky enough to get a team together that I really wanted to work with. I really wanted to work with Ken Thomas, who produced the last two Sigur Rós albums. And he listened to the demos, and he called me up, and he just told me, he said, the songs make me feel good, and I would really like to work on the record. And that was good enough for me. You know, that was kind of like what we were trying to do. We wanted to make an album that you kind of listen to it, and you don't know why, but it makes you feel good.
Yeah, I mean, the album has a very sort of live feel to it, very warm feel, as well as having sort of some wonderful orchestral arrangements on it. Was this a chance for you to explore an interest in blues and cinematic music, and was it refreshing for you after a predominantly electronic period?
You know what, that's a really good description, because a lot of the songs, for me, like, they come out of, like, visual sort of experiences. They come out from a very sort of, I kind of, like, go to a very visual place when I'm writing, and I definitely react to what somebody else is playing, or, you know, so if Knox is sitting there playing some chords to me or something, the melodies sort of come from somewhere, you know. I always think they come from the universe. It's got nothing to do with me. I just have to be kind of present to receive it. And I heard Keith Richards said once, he's like a sort of radio antenna or something. He said he's got nothing to do with any of the songs. He said he's just got to be tuned in, man. Yeah. And I know what he's talking about. It was awesome. That's kind of how it came about. And it was really refreshing, because to sit with somebody and just start from the ground up and, like, explore ideas and explore some blues stuff. You know, both of us, Knox and I, are both big sort of Muddy Waters fans, and John Lee Hooker, Howlin' Wolf, and also a lot of sort of jazz stuff as well, like Coltrane and Miles Davis and Billie Holiday. And then on the rock and roll side, there's definitely Stones, Stooges, you know, New York Dolls, that kind of stuff. So that kind of came, early Bowie, definitely early Bowie.
I guess lyrically, many of the songs on Paper Monsters are presumed autobiographical. Why did you feel that it was now time to express yourself in this way, yet you couldn't do this within Depeche?
You know what, I don't know. I really can't. I get asked that question a lot, and it's really hard for me to answer. I just think a lot of it was probably I didn't feel like my ideas were good enough. You know, bottom line, that's probably it.
But you've been in the band for 22 years.
I know, but it's, you know, I know that's incredible, but I guess I'm just a very slow learner.
Martin Gore also released his debut solo album last month, within a week of yours. With both of you doing solo work, I guess the big question is, does this spell the end or a long break from Depeche Mode?
Well, we're certainly taking a break from each other, and I think that's something that we definitely need to do. And for me, it's just I'm really enjoying what I'm doing right now. I'm enjoying writing, and I want to continue to do that. And for me, it's like I've talked to Martin about this, and in the future, you know, we plan to sort of get together maybe like in January or something. I'm going to be touring with this album to at least the end of the year. And hopefully, if things start going well for us in Australia, you know, you never know. You might see us on a big day out or something pop up there. That would be fantastic. I'd love to come to Australia. You know, I haven't ever really been to Australia as much as I would like to have. But at the moment, seem to be getting a good reaction to my record. And you know, you never know. But you know, we just basically said, look, we'll get together in January, we'll talk about it and see what happens. But for me, it's I have to be involved in the writing.
Yeah.
And for there to be an openness to change and to try new things. And if that's not there, and also the enthusiasm, if it's I suppose we should get together and make a record. I mean, I'm just not. That's not what making music is supposed to be about, and certainly that would be an insult to Depeche Mode. It would be an insult to Martin, to our fans, and it would not be good. But you know what? I never say never, because you know I've done that too many times in my life, and I'm never going to do that again.
What are your impressions of Martin's album? Has he given his thoughts on yours?
I haven't heard what he's. I heard through somebody else that he was surprised. I don't know what that means, but I think he thought it was going to be maybe a lot heavier or something, but I don't really know. I have listened to his album. I've only listened to it a couple of times. I particularly liked the Julie Cruz cover that he did, but, you know, it's kind of like, and I don't mean this in a detrimental way, but it's what I expected. You know, it's what I expected, and so if anything, that was a little bit of a disappointment. I'd love to see Martin stretch himself a bit more, you know. But he was really reflecting on, you know, a lot of his influences.
Well, I wanted to talk about more the dance side of things. There's a great set of remixes on Dirty Sticky Floors by Lexicon Avenue and Junkie XL. As with all the Depeche stuff, you've used Tenaglia, Bushwhacker, Francois K in the past. How do you keep your fingers so firmly on the pulse of Clubland, or is it solely a record company decision?
No, that was... Well, this time around, I really kind of got into it a lot more. I really liked the Junkie XL thing that he did for the Elvis thing.
Yeah.
I thought it was really cool. And I also did something for him. He's got a record coming out soon, I think, an album coming out, and I did a song with him that we collaborated on called Reload. Also, some of the other stuff, this guy Howard, who works at Mute, we just kind of talked a lot about it, and I wanted the stuff to just kind of really be up tempo and give the song another sort of twist, you know, take it out of that kind of sleazy rock and roll area and kind of pump it up a bit.
Yeah. I mean, who has surprised you and delighted you by their remix of one of your songs in the past, whether it's something off the album or from Depeche?
I really liked, it was pretty extreme at the time and pretty out there, and to be honest, quite ahead of its time, was all the Adrian Sherwood On You Sound stuff that he did, for People of People and Master and Servant. It was really out there, man.
Yeah, I noticed there's a few white labels at the moment of the Lexicon Avenue mix of Only When I Lose Myself. Was this a rejected remix, or why aren't they used? How do they appear on white labels?
I don't know. I think sometimes that's done really because we wanted to do a limited thing that was just really for DJs and stuff like that, and wanted it to kind of be special or something. But I liked what they did, and that's why I wanted them to do something for Dirty Sticky Floors. I liked what they did.
Now, the look and feel of the album artwork and Dirty Sticky Floors video reminds me of the videos from the DM's sort of ultra period. I gather from the interviews the ultra period looked to be a fulfilling time in your life with the resurgence of the band. Are you in the same frame of mind at the moment with Paper Monsters, as in opening up the real Dave to your audience?
Well, certainly it feels like that. I mean, and at times it's kind of really scary, them sort of come out from behind behind the monsters and actually showing myself, you know. And a lot of that is about fear. I mean, when I'm up on stage, it's like I can just kind of let go of all that stuff, and I've always really enjoyed it. But I wanted to make a record that, for me, was, you know, like I said, very visual, but at the same time, I always thought about performing. I always thought about, how would I perform this song? How can I, I can see an audience, I can see people's faces when I'm singing, Hold On, or, you know, Black and Blue Again, or, Bottle Living. It's like I, you know, that gets me off. It's like I really enjoy that, but I just felt like it's something that I could not, hold inside of me anymore. You know, I had to take, you know, what for me felt like a, it certainly is a new, like something new happening in my life, you know, working with different people, and I'm just like really enjoying it, man, like at the moment. It's so much fun. Everybody's like so up for it. Great bunch of guys. We're all going to be traveling around together on a bus. I'm really looking forward to it.
It's a really refreshing album. I only heard it for the first time yesterday, and I've probably played it twice so far. One of my favorite songs is Bitter Apple. I mean,
well, you know what? It wouldn't be the first. It's like,
yeah,
that song is actually one of my favorites too.
Yeah,
and,
I was about to say, what's your favorite? What are you closest to on the album, and what will be the second single?
Well, the next single is probably going to be I Need You, but I would love for Bitter Apple to be a single at some point. You know, I just think it's very simple. It's a song about love. I know that sounds like cliches, but it's, you know, it was, for me, it's about remembering love. It's not like being in love.
Yeah.
It's like remembering love. And I remembered it through somebody else. I remembered it through, at the time, this girl that I met in Arizona, who now is my wife.
I wanted to ask you a couple of history questions.
Right.
Anton Corbin could be almost called the fifth member of Depeche by being responsible for most of your videos and artwork.
Yep.
You give credit to Anton for renewing the band's visual component for each period of your career.
And, without a doubt.
Yeah, I mean, was it the band that purposely changed the way you looked on stage and in print, or was it solely up to Anton?
No, we kind of, to be honest, I would always collaborate with Anton a lot more than the other guys. They weren't so much interested in it. But the visual side of things, it's always interested me. Certainly when it comes to performing. And, you know, Anton and I, like I said, have always kind of got on in that department. And, you know, for me, yeah, he definitely understood what we were trying to do musically. And he still does with me. You know, he kind of knows me that well. That he knows how to catch me in a sort of like just a moment when I'm just being Dave or whatever. And, not kind of playing up to the cameras, and he's just a really sweet guy. We're both Taurians. It must be something to do with that.
I'm a Taurian too, actually.
Well, there you go.
You're the 9th, aren't you? 9th of May.
9th of May. When's yours?
19th.
Wow, cool. Anton's the 20th.
Oh, okay. Watching the Devotional concert on video, I feel it's probably one of the most powerful performances I've seen by a band. Yep, I know behind the stage the band was in turmoil. How
yeah.
Does Depeche Mode keep it together so well on stage when really the relationships between the members were falling apart?
Yeah, well, to be honest, being on stage was the only time when we just put all that stuff aside.
Yeah.
You know, it was about the performance and with the help of all the fans. I mean, you can't not, like, you know, there was definitely friction between all of us, but I think that was the one tour when at some point that really worked, even though it damn near killed all of us. But the friction that was up there, I think you can only really do that once, you know, with a bunch of guys. It was just we were all going in separate sort of directions, and the thing got so friggin' huge. I mean, it was ridiculous. I think we had like 150 people working for us on the road at that time. It was insane, and, you know, it was just this huge fucking circus on the road, and it went on for like 18 months or something as well. So I mean, Fletcher actually didn't even do the last 3 months of the tour. He went home, and Daryl, one of the roadies, like took over his part.
Oh god.
I mean, that's pretty much where it was at.
Yeah.
I mean, it was. I mean, I think it was a really impressive show. Like I said, I think you can only kind of do that once. We, you know, after that, it was kind of like, you know, we had to regroup. Alan left the band. It was like a lot of, you know, that's happened quite a few times in the 22 years that we've been together, where we've had to like stop, look at what's going on, see what we want to do. Do we want to do this? Have we got another record? You know, that's one of the great things about Depeche. You know, is that we've Mute Records is that they've enabled us to like always like rebuild and recreate, and I think, you know, if we're going to make another record together, that's what it has to be. We have to relook at what we're doing.
One of the earliest memories I have of the band is seeing the band do Blasphemous Rumours on Top of the Pops. I mean, I remember seeing Martin using a bicycle wheel as an instrument, was semi-dressed in bondage gear. Looking back, was it exciting for the band to be breaking new musical and visual territory? And did you really have any idea that these songs would be creating a template for electronic music that we hear today?
The last part of the question, no, not really. We would always just be doing what we were capable of doing, and we were very influenced by music music that was coming out of Germany at the time that we liked, like Neubauten and, you know, bands like Test Department and later Nine Inch Nails and some of the earlier stuff like Can and Neu and Kraftwerk. So we were influenced by those kind of bands that, not so much musically, but like the fact that they were trying to create new sounds of their own. So yeah, at the time it was kind of like, we'd go around, we'd get to a studio is like go into the kitchen and look for what we could smash and hit and burn and make noises with. And, you know, it was a fun time. It was like very new, the idea of like taking a sound and making it, you know, putting it into a loop and making it part of a song was kind of a new thing. So, but I mean, certainly to us, and it was just fun exploring those areas, you know, it took some effort and, that's a good thing. I think it's really important that you always kind of sort of change and try new things and not rely on old ideas.
I mean, especially for going on Top of the Pops and BBC. I mean, this is 1984.
Yeah, it was funny, you know, because we'd be on there and they'd be looking at us in a really weird way.
Yeah.
We had a lot of fun with it because we certainly didn't fit in with anything. And, you know, as much as the press tried to group us in with a few bands that were around at that time, like Duran Duran and Spandau Ballet and these bands, we couldn't have been any different.
Well, back to the present. Could you be visiting Australia in the near future?
I'm really hoping so. In fact, I was just talking to my manager, and we're touring around, we start in Europe in June,
yeah.
Then we do the States, then we go back to Europe and back to the States and by the end of the year. And I just said, look, you know, if all goes well and things, you know, because there seems to be a little bit of a buzz over there in Australia about this record,
yeah.
Which I'm really excited about, and I would love to come there. You know, I understand there's a great festival there. Was it the Big Day Out? Or
Big Day Out is the thing here.
Is that like January?
Yeah, late January, goes into February around the country.
If all goes well, you never know. I mean, I'm hoping that we'd be able to come there.
You'd be most welcome here, I'm sure.
Thank you.
Dave, thanks so much for taking time out to talk to me. Good luck with the album and the tour.
Cheers, mate. You take care.
Take it easy. Bye.
Cheers, mate. Bye.